All right, everybody, how's it going? Welcome. We are finally here. It is February of 2020, which means we are here for Death Flag 2020. I forgot to put the logo up. I'm a stupid. I feel like I could do that real quick while I'm chit-chatting, perhaps. Let me see if I can find everything for that so I can have the death. Oh god, see, it's all black, so it doesn't even hardly even make some sense. I guess it's still really dumb, but hey, we're here at Death Flag. You can't really see the flag part because that's just the way it's gonna be, because I didn't put the white thing around it, but that's all right. But we will have a full kickoff show. I think that's what I'm going to start doing from now on, is having like a full, I'm going to use the full extent of my pre-show to have the kickoff stuff happening. So with that, we'll have some of the lesser storylines, as well as I think at least one developmental match. And I'll start here with Death Flag. In fact, we'll transition immediately into the Pro Wrestling Ignition Showcase match, which will feature two members of Pro Wrestling Ignition here tonight. We are in the Tacoma Dome in Tacoma, Washington. And we have Tacoma, Washington's own Shane Strickland, who is a fairly recent hire for Ignition, taking on former Hawkeye Pro guy. He's been around for a while, but now down in Ignition, Patrick Clark. So we will have Shane Strickland versus Patrick Clark on the kickoff. And as well, it's been a bit of a boiling over point here between Sterling James Keenan and Ted DiBiase Jr. We'll have the official comeback match for the both of these guys, Sterling James Keenan squaring off against Ted DiBiase Jr. Ted Jr. Has been kind of off and on with wrestling. He hasn't really officially wrestled in a company in quite a while. And for Sterling James Keenan, at 2020, I think that's probably at least a good 5 years or so that he's officially not been. He's officially not been in the ring. I can't remember when his last match was, but I think it was probably about 2014, 2015. I'd have to actually see when he officially retired, but either way, I think it's been at least a good 5 years now. If it's 2020, but yeah, Sterling James Keenan versus Ted DiBiase Jr. Both these guys' first official matches in Hawkeye Pro Wrestling as well. So we'll see what happens there as well. I don't have it officially listed, but we will have some sort of women's match on the kickoff show, some sort of singles match to determine a spot in the Women's Opportunity Trophy ladder match next month at Blackout. So we have that match going on, and we're going to have another qualifying match for it. Of course, 2 days ago on Thursday, Dash Chisako won her match against Miyu Yamashita to earn her spot. And speaking of Dash and Miyu, they will both be involved tonight on the Death Flag card. It is Kairi Hojo and Dash Chisako versus Mayu Iwatani and Miyu Yamashita. Mayu and Miyu have been, they seem to be on the same page. Of course, they've been sort of at odds with one another. Mayu in general has been at odds with the rest of Heyman International over how she feels she's been treated. It seems like perhaps that's passed. We'll see if anything happens with there. But of course, Kairi and Dash, both with their own accomplishments and their own things going on here. Kairi, of course, next month at Blackout will have a match for the Hawkeye Pro Women's Championship. And of course, Dash will be involved in the Women's Opportunity Trophy ladder match. So we'll see if they can beat out Mayu and Miyu. Speaking of, we will have Shinsuke Nakamura versus Taylor Mulligan. Taylor Mulligan, of course, showing up last month at Dead Storm Rising and attacking Shinsuke Nakamura. And they've been kind of throwing both verbal and physical jabs at one another for the last few weeks or so, and the challenge was thrown down. And we will see Shinsuke Nakamura take on Taylor Mulligan. I know Nakamura has been fighting for the he's been dying for the opportunity to teach him a bit of a lesson and teach him respect for the older wrestlers. Speaking of which, Alex Reynolds has been on his path to redemption. Of course, he showed up just a couple of weeks ago back again after being kicked to the curb by Brother Ray. And it seems as if Alex Reynolds still has his sights on Brother Ray. However, he wants to prove himself against Brother Ray's new golden boy in Tama Tonga. Of course, Alex Reynolds was Brother Ray's original golden boy. And kicked him to the curb, and it seems as though Tama Tonga is the new one. Alex Reynolds will get a chance to prove himself, however, against him one-on-one. Speaking of, Kenny Omega will get to prove himself one-on-one against Chris Jericho in a street fight. Kenny Omega's personal crusade against Los Ingobernables continues. We had the fight against Tetsuya Naito at Final Fight. We had the match against Hiromu Takahashi at Dead Storm Rising. And tonight it is Chris Jericho's turn. It is a street fight. Kenny Omega has not taken kindly to Chris Jericho's involvement in Los Ingobernables. And Kenny Omega continuing the crusade tonight in his hopes and desires in destroying Los Ingobernables in Hawkeye Pro Wrestling. We have three championship matches tonight. The first of the championship matches to the other members of the Elite, Kenny Omega's elite friends, the Young Bucks, the new Hawkeye Pro Tag Team Champions. I think they've only had one tag team title defense thus far. They beat Los Ingobernables looks like last month before Dead Storm Rising, and they'll have their second official title defense tonight against the Cleanup Crew. For a while it seemed like it was going to be Tama Tonga and Robert Roode. However, Samoa Joe coming back and proving himself able to compete after his injury, and we will see how they do as the Cleanup Crew gets a shot at the Hawkeye Pro Tag Team Championships against the Young Bucks. And we have the Hawkeye Pro Women's Championship on the line. If it freaking clicks, oh my God, thank you. Candice LeRae, who earned herself a shot at the women's title in the Sudden Death 4-Way last month at Dead Storm Rising, has earned herself a shot against Io Shirai. Io Shirai, after the wars that she's been through with the likes of Mayu Iwatani and Kana, has kind of taken the last several weeks to just not pay no attention to Candice LeRae. Well, Candice LeRae didn't take too kindly of that, and it seems as though she made sure that Io Shirai knew who she was and knew what type of threat she was just 2 days ago at Blackout. We'll see if Io Shirai is able to compete as we will have this women's championship match. We'll see. Candice LeRae did hit a reverse Rana on Io Shirai. She wasn't carried out or anything. She was able to walk out eventually on her own. So perhaps Io Shirai will start taking Candice LeRae a little bit seriously tonight as she defends the women's title. And in the main event, Pete Dunne, the new Hawkeye Pro Heavyweight Champion, cashed in the Opportunity Trophy. Had been holding on to it for a few months, and ended up losing his match to Juice Robinson at one end of Dead Storm Rising. But by the end, cashed in on the Shane Hollister Kushida match, and he is the new Heavyweight Champion. Kushida did not take kindly to that at all. However, a lot of contenders possibly aiming for Pete Dunne. Kushida ended up getting this match by beating Shane Hollister and Juice Robinson in a three-way dance on adrenaline just a couple of weeks ago. And Kushida has said that Pete Dunne is a fraud, and the only reason that he is the heavyweight champion is because of that Opportunity Trophy. Pete Dunne will get a chance to show his worth against Kushida, but of course Kushida will have his chance to prove that Pete Dunne may or may not be a fraud, and we'll see which one of these guys will walk away with the Hawkeye Pro Heavyweight Championship. And that is the match card for Death Flag. Whoops. Move it back on over here. It'll be very interesting to see what happens here. I think I've pretty much settled with everything already. While that was happening while I was talking, I set up the pay-per-view stuff and all that, so there's nothing really else to do. I made sure that we are scheduled to be in the Tacoma Dome. I will say it looks like we'll get very, very close. We will get very, very close because the Tacoma Dome fits 16,000 people. We are set to have 15,916. So it is a toss-up to see if perhaps the extra things that I generally book for my pay-per-views are enough to sell out, or if we'll end up maybe about 100 shy. But I gotta say, 100 short of a sellout is still practically a sellout to me. Doesn't really. I would like the sellout behind it, but, you know, money's money. All right. Yeah, Pete Dunne always looks like he just had diarrhea. To be fair, yeah, Pete Dunne just always looks like he got arrested for dealing drugs. Pete Dunne kind of always had that look at him. All right, so let me see here. Borrow from developmental, of course. Oh, man, I feel like I need to get his new picture up because that's just such a fresh-faced Adam Page. I feel like eventually once I get him doing some stuff to get his psychology up, we'll have to put Hangman Page in one of these. But for right now, we need Patrick Clark for tonight. And we need Shane Strickland for tonight. Because we have a match, of course, on the pre-show, the kickoff. We go move on down here. Shane Strickland versus Patrick Clark. There we go. Let's see what happens. Oh, hey, Hockey, what's up? Let's see. 63 psych, 80 stam. That's not too bad. 56. Ooh, that's psychology. See, this is why I have them running like a couple shows a week, so they have a lot of opportunities to wrestle. So we'll see what happens. Meth before aftershocks, 20-year-old versus 23-year-old done. I think I'll just have him go like 10 minutes. How about that? Just a nice little 10-minute match. Let's give the win to Shane Strickland, because, you know, hometown boy. How many times is he going to be able to have a match in the Tacoma Dome in his hometown? By the way, like, Shane Strickland, like, his, because I guess there's a couple of different, themes for him. Like, he has, like, his AEW theme. He has, like, one of his main themes, but I remember seeing something. Yeah, there was a song made specifically for Strickland that was, like, It was dope. Dizzy on a beat. I don't know if this is gonna. It probably won't get hit, but I still feel like playing it. But it's pretty. I like it. I'll play this. No, it's gonna get loud. Hang on. There you go. It'll be just a little bit louder than usual, but yeah. There we go. Decisive win. Open match. I think we're good. So we've got that. We've got... let's see. Every one of your YouTube videos has copyright claims on it. I mean, all my TEW ones do. If they're monetized, they're not monetized by me. Yep, right in time for a big pay-per-view. Yeah, your first ever stream. Well, welcome. I appreciate it. Let me see. I feel like most of it comes from the yeah, let me just make this real quick. Sterling, oh God, come on. Sterling James Keenan. Ted DiBiase Jr. There we go. Imagine Dragons claim one of those. Yeah, that's why I try to do that. I've become very well what's the word? I become very well used to. Let me try that again. I've really gotten to know the music policies page of YouTube in the creator studio, so I know what will get hit and what won't get hit. Well, I know a lot of the stuff's going to get hit and monetized, but I know what's going to get monetized and what's going to get straight up muted. That's generally what I've done. I spent a lot of time looking through that. So what can they do well? Psychology is a 73. Okay. What is his... Okay, yeah, that's not too bad. His psychology is a 55. That's the only thing. Yeah, those 210 views per bit. Yeah, I mean, I don't exactly do this for, like, my I don't, you know, this isn't my income thing, so... Yeah. There we go. Okay. That was good. Yeah, so I don't think they can really call it in the ring, but they should be able to go like 14. I think that's not too bad. Sterling James Keenan. Trying to see what that says. Velox, thank you very much for the host. I appreciate it. Let me see here. Open match, decisive. I'm guessing he already has the 13th step on there, but just to make sure. He wins with decision. There we go. Whoops. No, that ain't no one. That ain't no main show. All right, 32 minutes, so I got to include my one-on-one. I have no idea what my two women should be. Okay, so I know who's going to be in next month's blackout, but I need to find out who would be the best to, like, throw in there. You know what? Yeah. Let's do Hikaru Shida and let's do, like, Mercedes Martinez. That might actually turn out pretty well. We'll see. 80. Wow, she can call a match. She can call a match. You know what? She can probably call a match too. You know what? I could probably do my storytelling match on the pre-show, and it'll probably still count. Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. Sheeta getting the win. Open it. Decisive win. There you go. I think they could probably go for 15. And pre-show that shit. There you go. So those are your three pre-show matches. I think that's probably the way to do it as well right there. Open it up with Shane Strickland, Patrick Clark for Ignition. Sterling James Keenan here. I might even just put... I don't think it'll mean anything, but... Just a highlight of that. And I'm always kind of wonder why WWE doesn't do that. Can you imagine how much more exposure like NXT guys might get if, say, they take their ridiculously long pre-shows and instead of like having some like a bunch of like stupid panel discussions, like imagine they just take 10 minutes, just take a 10 minute chunk of their pre-shows and be like, okay, we're going to have this NXT guy and this NXT guy, and you're going to go out before the pre, you're going to go out in the pre-show, like just have like a random, like imagine like a normal, like a random North American championship match. Like imagine you just, okay, we need to get people hyped for the pay-per-view. We want to showcase our NXT guys. You take 10 minutes, put Adam Cole versus Ricochet out there for 10 minutes. Just go. I feel like that's hardly anything. It's not technically on the, I mean, it's, it would kind of be on the network. But yeah, it's like, okay. I feel like it'd do so well. People would watch the pre-show if it was like, hey, we're getting these two NXT guys out there to do this. All right. I feel like, should I have angles? I should. I mean, we're doing 15 minutes of, I mean, we're doing a whole thing, so. Let's see here. Sterling James Keenan, Ted DiBiase Jr. How about this? Sterling James Keenan, Ted DiBiase Jr. We'll rate them on entertainment. It'll be like off-screen appearances, I guess. Vignette plays showing the rivalry of, whoops, rivalry of SJK's and Ted's debuts leading to match. There you go. What, have you crippled them? Is that what you've done? You've crippled your women? Why are you crippling women? And who are you crippling women with? Whoops. Oh my god, I keep forgetting to do pre-show. Oh, they got physical decline. Okay. Yeah, I got a fair amount of that because I got a lot of old guys, but I think the only like physical decline, like real physical decline that you can just watch someone withering away is Prince Devitt. It's kind of irritating. let's do that. And Sterling James Keenan and Ted DiBiase Jr. They can sell, right? 69. Nice. And 75. Okay. SJK refuses to let go of 13th step until refs pull them apart. SJK is still mad, but seems vindicated. Ah! Yeah. We'll just leave it at that. There we go. Usually that means making them take stunt bumps and pulling them with it, putting them with an unsafe worker. God damn. What's that? Prince Devitt versus Brock Lesnar. All right. Up next on Adrenaline, Prince Devitt faces Brie Bella in a kick your head off match. I'd say 4 minutes. Kind of puts him over a little bit. I guess a minor defeat and a low injury risk for it. And put it there. Let's see here. Hikaru Shida, she can come out with Hamada and Nakajima and Kaho. Reyna's out for Shida's match. She is looking forward to another chance to win women's opportunity trophy. There we go. I think I'll do like 4 minutes. She can cut the promo. I don't think the others need to cut. Oh god, Yeah, fuck it. We're doing the pre-show anyway, so why not? There we go. It's all in the pre-show. Who cares? Whoops. Oh, God damn it! I forgot to put that on the pre-show. Oh, my God. All right. Pre-show. There. Here we go. And we got 3 minutes of available show time left. So, none. Joey Styles. Shawn Michaels. Whoops. Just a minor success there. Styles at HBK. Styles at HBK. Quickly run down the Death Flag card and urge you to purchase the show. There you go. 3 minutes of like, hey, here's the card. Just so you know, there you go. We're out of time. Buy the pay-per-view. All right. So we're at Death Flag. Oh, my God. What should the first one be? Oh, man. How do we start this one? I think Mulligan versus Nakamura? I'm just looking at some of the... Yeah, we'll open up with Mulligan versus Nakamura. Wow, he's got some psychology to him. Okay. Yeah, oh, you know what? They can call this one in the ring. How about that? Let me see here. All right, people are going to be angry at this, but here you go. Cram a rocket up his ass. We're going. I know a certain Nakamura who's not going to be happy about taking the job here. And it's decisive of all things. 14 minutes. He is furious. Okay. Yeah, we should keep him strong. We should really keep him strong. He'll remain furious. Who cares? Oh, hang on. I gotta mute this. The damn cat's like scratching at the door, and I don't need her scratching up my door. I should take a picture of it someday, of the door jam when she scratches it, as well as the carpet in front. She's like dug a hole into the carpet. But yeah. Yeah, give me 1 second here. Okay. Not angry Nakamura like 45 right now. I was going to say, how old is Nakamura? He's got to put some people... Well, I think that was actually the whole reason why Nakamura... That was one of the big reasons why Nakamura left New Japan. Because I think he knew he wasn't going to pull off the sort of matches that they wanted out of him. Like Tanahashi can. So he was going to... Like, I feel like... He just sort of knows he was going to eventually, within the next couple years, get the Nagata Tenzan treatment. Maybe more the Nagata, because Tenzan and Kojima don't really hang around for anything. At least At least Nagata, like, was still kind of there. He'd probably get the Nagata treatment, but eventually move on. At least in WWE, he still has a little bit more left. Old man Nakamura gonna job to Switchblade Bo Dallas, though. I'm telling you that much. You'll be fine. All right, let's see here. Ooh, I feel like we should do the women's tag match. I feel like that's the next thing we got to do. Oh, I forgot to do Sadistic Tales versus the Revolution. All right, so that's, like, can we move that? Let's move that. Let's move that to Breakout, because we got to do the, yeah, because I think it's the more pressing thing is the Opportunity Trophy qualifier, which I probably should have put in there. Do I put that in there? Shut up. No. I love you, but fuck off. Go sleep. Women's OT qualifier. There we go. WWE probably pays them. Yeah, I would assume they probably pay him a lot of money. Wow, okay, man. the cat. That's why I usually shut my door. It's because the cat just meow, meow, meow. I'm just like, fuck. Can you just, I gotta tell the cat to, like, fuck off, because it's like, yo, you up in the way. Oh, that's right. The worst stamina here is Mayu. I should tell her to lose weight. She's already skinny as fuck. But maybe that'll increase her stamina. I guess 15 minutes will be about enough. Ooh, who's going to get the win? Kairi. Yeah, Kairi and Dash are going to win, so we'll give Kairi it, considering she's challenging for the title next month. Decisive win. If she doesn't fuck with the setup, just let her in. That's the reason why I shut the door, is she fucks with the setup. She likes rubbing her face on fucking everything and, like, clawing at shit. Like, there was actually a time I let her in, and then she just started pawing at the fucking cord, and it just started, like, ruining the microphone, because the cord is sensitive. So it's just, like, as soon as she just does that, and then she just rubs her face up against everything.
Why are you so weird?
Just go. No. No, I see what you're going to do.
Just go lay in the window. You like having the sun on you. Go.
AJ made $3 million. Jesus. Tanahashi made $900,000. That makes sense. Yeah, Victor open, decisive finish, let's see, yeah, that's why I don't let her in, it's because she gets into shit. I have, like, this lamp, and the lamp takes, like, 3 bulbs, and it's a nice little lamp, and it's a stand-up lamp, but it has this, like, almost fake bamboo look thing to it.
Come on, here, at least say hi to everyone before I put you back down. Here, say hi.
Can you meow?
Say hi. Oh, God. Okay.
Well. She's cute, but she's annoying. All right. I think we're good. 15 minutes. Victor open, decisive. Kairi wins. Cool. That's about all I need. Everything else, you guys figure it out. let's see. But yeah, I have this lamp, and it looks like it has like a box thing around it that kind of looks like maybe fake bamboo, but it's basically like, it's almost like rice paper. And she just started, I guess she just must have thought it was like some sort of what is it, like a scratching post. So she started treating it like a scratching post and started tearing holes in the thing. So now it's got like permanent tear holes in it because she just started treating it like a scratching post. So I was like, ah, fuck it. I just won't let her in because I can't keep an eye on her that way. God, what should be the next thing? I don't think we should go from tag team match to tag team match. So we got to put one of these matches in here. Jericho Omega, because Omega's going to have to carry Jericho, and I think it's going to do a little bit less than some of the others. Did I say Jericho carry Omega or Omega carry Jericho? Because I meant Omega carry Jericho, which is absolutely about to happen.
Oh my god, that 44 stamina.
We'll make it work. Do they have the brawling? They don't really. Hey, he's got 55 brawling. That's not terrible. You know, 61. Wait, what was his psychology again? All right. I could try to have him call it in the ring. I don't know. Let's go 20. Actually, let's go 19. Chono will do it. Let me look at this. Omega beating Jericho. Why do I keep getting emails? Let's see. Cena 8 million, H3 points. Damn. Ambrose made 2.7? Jesus. Open match. Yeah, we gotta slow build it, because if we're gonna give them... Yeah, we gotta slow build it, but we're gonna put him, like, right on the edge of like, the slow build, so he doesn't crap out on me. Decisive win. Okay. I should see if he'll take a stunt bump. Yeah, I figured. Maybe Omega should take a stunt bump? No, okay, he's not willing to... Come on. Omega's absolutely willing to take a stunt bump in reality. I wanted something, but yeah, it'll be fine. I think that'd be it. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. No, I think that'd be it. Omega wins. It's open. It's slow built. It's decisive. We know that Kenny Omega beat him. He's unhappy at the booking of this match. Really? How far down is Kenny Omega really? All right, so we're looking at what? We're in the Northwest. He's an 80. Where is Chris Jericho at? 84. That's 8 points. Fuck yourself. Let's see here. We've got... Oh, I feel like the tag match should be next. I want to space out some of the title matches at least. Ooh, how long could they go? I guess the better question is, how long should they go? Okay, so 73 stam is probably about where it should be. Let's go 20. And it's probably merch. Merch probably hasn't. You know, doesn't want to put the young guy Kenny Omega over. Yeah, 50-year-old Jericho blown up. Let's give it to Matt Jackson. Open match. Should they script it? Oh man. It prevents a natural flow, but for some reason a Young Bucks match is always so devoid of psychology, despite the fact that they both got in the 70s. It always is like, oh, there's a lack of psychology on display. It's like, why are every Young Bucks match like this? I mean, I have an idea why, but statistically they shouldn't. Do we want to go decisive or do we want to go... Ooh. Let's go decisive / pinfall. And we'll have Joe take the loss. Joe, I think, can handle it. So a quick roll-up on the cleanup crew means they still got a clean roll-up, but it's not... Oh, right. They still get the clean roll-up, and they still get the clean win. But there's still at least some questions about the fact that... Like, there's still at least the fact that they didn't straight up beat them. Lack of psychology is like minus 1 point, yeah. I'm honestly considering actually putting... I think I might actually put the... oh, man. Actually, yeah, we'll do that. Yeah. Let's see here. I think that would probably put Reynolds, Tama. I honestly, you know what? I'm going to put the women's match because Reynolds, Tama is probably going to be at least in the 90s. Reynolds, Tama always fucking delivers a home run. So, yeah. There's Candice LeRae has had great matches, but there's always a question mark about her matches. Like, her best one so far was in 82. And then she had that 94 against Kana, but, I mean, that's also still a question mark. She's had some good matches, but she's had some stinkers before, so let's just make that happen. Let's see, 82, 84, ooh, can she call it? Can she, yeah. You know what, if that storytelling already happened in the pre-show and I can keep it like that, that'd be great. Let's go, oh, man. What was her stamina again? 82. Okay. How about we go 19, but we don't slow build? We'll just see how hard they go. Io Shirai getting the win. I know there are a lot of people who are like, this obviously means Candice is going to win. No. No plans to have Candice win, but I wanted to make it seem like it. Yeah, so they don't go all out. That'll be fine. So, yeah, Io Shirai wins decisively, and Candice does her best. That's about it. Pretty straightforward, honestly, for the women's title match. Didn't want any real shenanigans happening. Bet inconsistency? Probably, actually, when you think about it. Consistency's an 80. Nick Jackson has been pulling off hundreds, yeah. His consistency is great. I don't know what it is. Maybe, I don't know. All right, then yeah, Reynolds versus Tama, which is going to go, they can definitely call this one in the ring, and they'll probably go 20-something. They'll probably go about 24. All right, Alex Reynolds getting the win. Open match, call it in the ring, slow build, decisive victory. I want botched interference on Alex Reynolds, on Tama by Brother Ray, but I don't want it coming into the finish. Or I could, yes, Tama will take a stunt bump. I think Reynolds will take one too, but I think Tama takes the stunt bump. That could end up leading to the finish. So maybe it's decisive? I don't know. Yeah, we'll still make it decisive. Like, Reynolds definitely beats him. But Brother Ray has something to do with it. On accident. So I think that'll be great. So yeah, open, called in the ring, work it slowly, which I don't even think is a necessity. But I'll do it anyway. Decisive. Brother Ray accidentally hits Tama Tonga. He takes a stunt bump. There you go. How many times have they fought, by the way? What was the last time they fought? It had to have been Festival, right? I mean, they were involved in the three-way, but the last one-on-one was that. And the last one-on-one before that was Ballad of the Fallen Angels. I'm trying to see here. Revolution in November. So they faced each other three times. This will be their fourth time. And the last time they faced each other one-on-one, they got a 94, which is why I'm putting Pete Dunne, or which is why I'm putting it so far in, like, deep into the card, because I know what it can do, as opposed to EO versus Candice. Hey, Okada, what's up? Dunne versus Kushida is also a question mark, but it's the heavyweight title match, so it's definitely going on last. 89-79, okay. 78-88. Okay, so I think they could probably go about 20 some too. I think they'll go about as long. And ooh, okay. I had an idea for this. Okay. Kushida wins. Open match. Call in the ring, slow build, cheap win. It is an intentional DQ finish. There you go. I think That was what I wanted. I think that's about it. Kushida to be the victor by DQ. Intentional DQ. Oh, they just made a joke because Pete Dunne, let me put it over here. Pete Dunne looks like a meth dealer in this picture. I mean, it's just a Pete Dunne. It's just how Pete Dunne looks. But apparently he looks like a meth dealer in that picture. Oh, he looks like a meth user. Okay. I guess he takes some of his own stuff. So I want to make sure this does it the way it's supposed to. Cheap finish, intentional DQ. Yeah, other than that, it's solid. So, yeah. My idea was Pete Dunne. Pete Dunne pulls a Randy Orton. If you've never seen one of my favorite finishes that I can't believe WWE's never done before, and I wonder if I can find it. Randy Orton versus John Cena at No Way Out 2008. That might work. I don't know if that actually... if I can actually find it, how that worked out. I think it was No Way Out. I'm pretty sure. It had to have been that one. See, now that I'm looking at it, I'm trying to see it. I'm trying to find it. Yeah. Yeah, it was this one. Yeah, okay. So this is the finish that I thought was Dunn and Kushida about to prove that Hollister's run was trash. This is one of my favorite finishes to a match. So it's John Cena and Randy Orton. They're about ready to come to the finish. Orton looks scared that John Cena looks like he's about to do something. Like he might actually win. So Orton just looks at the ref and then just fucking just slaps Mike Chioda. Just slaps Mike Chioda. Chioda just looks bewildered and calls for the bell. That is one of my favorite finishes that I can't believe they haven't done again. But that is my idea for Pete Dunne Kushida. Like Kushida is about ready to beat Pete Dunne. And Dunne just slaps the shit. Hang on. Justin King, no. I actually have Mike Chioda on roster. We're going to do it to Chioda again. Chioda's going to ref this, and Chioda's going to... Yeah, Justin King's doing this match anyway. Justin King's doing the co-main anyway. So we're going to slap Chioda again. This time it's Pete Dunne. Or forearms the ref. I mean, he's got to be up to actually call for the bell. Feels like it wouldn't make the most sense. No, I wouldn't make it a habit, but I just thought it'd be fun. I just wanted Pete Dunne to be like, I don't know what I wanted to go for. He's not just a complete chicken shit, but he's also like an ass. Because he's got good skills, and I think popularity-wise, he's not nearly up to Kushida's level. So there needs to be some fuckery with that. He can't just... There's no way... Like, I could still book it, but, like, he's not on Kushida's level. He's so not on Kushida's level. I'm not trying to go for, like, a Russo finish, but just occasionally you have some sort of fucky finish that no one's ever really done. Like no one's done in forever. Just intentionally slapping the referee just to lose by DQ and keep the title. It's amazing. All right. Shinsuke Nakamura. We'll do Selling and Taylor. He's a classic undeserving champion. Yeah, I mean that's what I was gonna go for, like Seth Rollins, like Seth Rollins' title run. You know, I think it was kind of memorable, but like I think he was a little too chicken shit. But like Seth Rollins around Dean Ambrose, I think was the perfect one. When Seth Rollins was champion and Dean Ambrose was challenging him, there was a clear Dean Ambrose can beat him, so Rollins has to find a way to somehow keep the belt. In fact, they had that one match that he lost by DQ because he pulled the ref out of the way. I think that was the one. Because it was like Dean Ambrose won, and then because that was the pay-per-view that was the source of I'd have to find it, the Rollins gif. Yeah, because it was like Elimination Chamber. That was the source of this gif. When he somehow kept the title by DQ. Like, he kept the title by DQ because he thought he lost it. So, yeah, it's kind of in that same vein. But, yeah, either way. Let's see here. Let's do that low injury risk. Kind of puts him over there because we're going to do... All right. Hey, Patrick, what am I now, a bad booker? Oh, come on. I'm not doing fucked finishes every month. Not to mention, it's Pete Dunne. We did this shit last year with Pete. The idea of Pete Dunne and fucked finishes, they just go together. Like, name a more iconic duo than Pete Dunne and fucked finishes. let's see here. Hope you get a 20 for that finish. Yo, do you remember last year's main event? Last year's main event was Alex Reynolds and Pete Dunne, and it went to a double countout. And I think it got like a 94. I'll be fine. Pete Dunne had a fucked finish in the main event of last year's match. Death Flag 2019. Pete Dunne in the main event. With a fucked finish. Death Flag 2020. Pete Dunne in the main event with a fucked finish. It's just academic at this point. Nakamura entrance. Interrupted by Mulligan. As he attacks. And throws him in the ring. There we go. Let's see here. Three. It only takes three. Nakamura comes out, does his thing. Mulligan beats him up, throws him in the ring. Ding, ding. Taylor Mulligan. We'll do his selling. He'll sell his match. Major success because you just beat Shinsuke Nakamura clean as a whistle. Mulligan can barely contain his shock as his hand is raised for beating Nakamura. There you go. Like 3 minutes. We need something that like puts him over. Like, yo, just beat this dude clean as a whistle in the middle of the ring. Let's see here. Threw a cheap finish on a pay-per-view called Death Flag, a hardcore pay-per-view. Maybe not the best idea. To be fair, I never said Death Flag is a hardcore pay-per-view. We have one street fight. I'd say Blackout is closer to it because Blackout has more going on. That's closer to the hardcore type one. But yeah, either way. If all the Mae Young Classic winners are Japanese, you'll eat Vegemite. Okay. When's that? Oh, that Evolution. I forget when that Evolution pay-per-view is happening. Yeah. God damn it.
I don't think... Okay, I feel a few things wrong with this. I don't think... Now, I could be wrong, because I didn't think they'd maybe take Kairi and Io. But I think they don't take Mayu. I think Mayu stays with Stardom and Ring of Honor. Tam would be kind of cool, but I don't see them taking Tam. I think Tam's still got a little ways to go. Even 2020, like, I feel like Tam's not quite up there yet. She's good, but yeah. Jungle Kiona would be... Jungle Kiona is bae. I don't think WWE will take her, though. Yosuke Santa Maria just made me laugh. I'd be shocked to see that happening. Yosuke Santa Maria in the fucking Mae Young Classic, though. Oh, my God. I'd buy WWE Network for everybody I know. If he ended up in there. Yeah, Blackout is next. Either way, goddamn. Okay. Heyman International versus... Heyman International means Paul Heyman's got to come out with Mayu and Miyu. There we go. Minor success is here. Heyman intros Mayu and Miyu. And warns Dash and Kairi. Whoops. Kairi. Kairi. They made a mistake with this because they Dash and Kairi made a mistake and may not make it to... Damn it. Here, we'll just put B.O. as Blackout. Fuck it. Alright. 4 minutes, I'd say. Doesn't need to be too long. I mean, 4 minutes is still... I feel like 4 minutes when you're doing a promo is forever. Alright, Dash and Kairi. So, Dash... Kairi... sell their match... Dash and Kairi celebrate as Kairi motions that she is looking to win the title at Blackout. So she does the belt motion. This is the same WWE took Riddle immediately after he was in talks with New Japan. Yeah, good point. Even involved taking all of Stardom and killing it. I mean, you did mention Kagetsu. I think they'll be fine. Although I gotta tell you, I don't know how much money Stardom won't have if they take Tam out. She got two like photo books and God knows how many autograph pictures. That you can buy right now. and I know that people are willing to buy them because I have one of the photo books and one of the 8x12s. So I know that people are willing to buy them. Oh, that's Hana's new attire. What the fuck are these that's what? That's Hana? There's no way that's Hana. That's just some black girl they brought in. That's not Hana. That is not Hana Kimura. That's just some black chick they brought in. It seems like her hair would be way too long anyway, because Hana's got like shorter hair. Yeah, she's got 10 different pictures on Stardom World. She's the only one you could buy 8x12s from. Either way, goddamn. Okay,
Dash Kyrie did that. Yeah, they don't need to spend more than 3 minutes on that. Minor success on that. There we go. I'm gonna have to look it up on some of the usual places I go to, and see if they discuss it. That is fucked though. If that's Hana Kimura's new look, because she's great, and I don't know why they would fucking ruin her look. Like, it looks like her hair's just always way too short for that, though. There's no way that can possibly be correct. See, now you got me fucked up. There's no way. I'm subscribed to too much shit that doesn't tell me that happened. Okay, either way. Goddamn. Okay. I just need to worry about other shit. This is why Tokyo Joshi Pro exists. Okay, so we had the post thing, Jericho versus Omega. Ooh, okay. What do I want to do here? I think Elon Musk has been watching too much anime today. I saw someone retweeted a post where he talked about Your Name, the movie, which is one of the best anime movies ever. But then he literally just posted about something a few hours ago that said, I need to build a, like, it's time to create a mecha. He's talking about building a fucking mecha now. Like, not the religious mecha, but an actual, like, fucking Evangelion mech. Alright, I need to get on the page here. Maybe not Jericho. Oh, God. I feel like I need something. Was it a double turn with Hana? What? I need to see what happened. Your Name is trash for normie trash like Elon Musk? Wow. Say what you want about Elon Musk, but if you tell me that Your Name is normie trash, I feel like I gotta I gotta come kick your ass. Let's see here. You criticize my gear. I'm so far better. Why? Hana in fucking Hana in Oedo Tai was great though. It's weird, yet no more Oedo Tai, it's all about Hana now. Oh no, I know a certain image board who's gonna have a field day just crying over Hana's new look. I know they're gonna fucking hate it. Yeah, I see her Twitter, yeah. Yeah, my sources are fucked up. My sources are pretty dead on sometimes, though. let me see. I do get there's a lot of unrealism there, but I understand. let's see. You can see thigh meat. Oh my god. You can see thigh meat too if you're willing to buy certain magazines. Not like really bad ones, but same ones that like EO posed for before she left for WWE, and I thank her. I'm getting way off topic. Let's get Chris Jericho out there. Let's see. Entertainment, minor success. Actually, let's do Jericho and Kenny Omega. Let's make it kind of a... selling or overness? Maybe overness. Let's see. Jericho and Omega come out and has a tense moment. Oh, let's see. Jericho and Omega, let's see. Entrances in Street Fight gear. Tense moment before laying into each other. I know so many lens flare epileptic people have seizures. What? Jesus. You know what other movie I did enjoy was A Silent Voice. A Silent Voice was good. And I think a lot of people didn't like it as much as Your Name. I thought A Silent Voice was really good. Because it really made you feel some shit. Like, God, did I feel so fucking sad throughout so much of that movie. It felt a little melodramatic at times, but God. I'd say 4 minutes. Yeah, we want it to be like tense moment of there you go, then boom, 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 boom. Let's see, Kenny Omega, he'll just sell. And then Chris Jericho, sell. Not switching lives just an excuse to give a talk of Shun's fan service and explain away with awkwardness. Is this what we're gonna do? I feel like this is what we're gonna do now. So we're gonna. Oh my god. The exclusive Kimura album will be available soon. Oh my god, if that actually happens, Hana Kimura has fucking diss tracks. I'm sure it's just a joke, but it'd be funny as fuck. Oh god. So yeah, let's see. Omega barely able to stand. Limps away as Jericho lies amongst weapon debris. How about that? Like rubble. Just rubble, but with like tables and chairs. Spend your college career on that album. Let's see. I'd say success. How about that? There we go. Push that up here. I won't say that I wasn't at least entertained by Your Name, and I won't say that I wasn't entertained by a video that was made that was actually by an anime shit poster that was I think. It was literally Your Name, but just Mitsuha noises. That's all it was just Mitsuha noises. So, maybe I am as trash as the anime that people don't enjoy. Let's see here. Cleanup crew, Young Bucks. Oh, God. All right, do I want to have one Young Bucks come up? Cleanup crew, how about that? So, Samoa Joe. Actually, yeah, that makes a much better idea because Joe and Rude can actually cut a fucking promo. So, let's make that happen. Joe and Rude out. Joe is feeling better than ever after his injury. And ready to destroy Young Bucks. Ah. The Bucks. There we go. Wow. Oh no. That's a thing that exists. I feel like because it is wrestling related, I should at least showcase it. I feel like I should at least showcase on. Oh my god! I want to see it again. Why are Liger and Tanahashi just awkwardly dancing. I want to make sure this is saved for all eternity on my live stream.
I don't even.
Sure, why not? Fantastic. In time you complete your college career and not have stopped streaming, I'll have a white collar job and probably kids. You might be right. I'm not sure. I'm not sure when I'm going to stop streaming. I don't know. Basically when I don't feel like it anymore. That's basically when I've decided. I don't know when that'll be, honestly. Let's see here. Move that to there. All right, Young Bucks cleanup crew. Let's see here. Matt Jackson, Nick Jackson, Samoa Joe, Robert Roode, Tyler the Boomer. Selling. Bucks haul it out of the ring after their win as Joe is furious and begs them back in. For a fight. I was gonna put a beat down, like he's just motioning, like, get the hell back in here, motherfucker. You're gonna get your ass kicked for that. I'll make sure of it. Let's see here. Let's see. Old enough to be a boomer. You do know I'm considered a millennial too, right? I believe so. I believe technically I fall under millennial. Let's see. Dates and age range definitions. Yeah, earliest dates from 1997. They say 1977 to 1994. Because, like, or I've also heard it as, like, Generation Y. Hang on. Uh-oh. I'm hearing my headphones start to go out a little bit. That's not good. Uh-oh. Sorry. I'm trying to mess with it because now I'm just... It's so weird because now I... Uh-oh. I feel like I might have to get new headphones at some point. That's not good. Sorry, I'm trying to do this, but now I got the music kind of just hanging out in one ear. Hang on. Hey! That seemed to help a little bit, just slamming it against the desk. All right, either way, you've got that figured out. 3 minutes. I guess a minor success because they won, so hey. And put that there. Io Shirai, Candice LeRae, Paul Heyman, Io Shirai. Entertainment. Oops, minus success. Heyman intros Io, but Io takes the mic and tells LeRae she done effed up with that reverse Rana. Now, of course, she wouldn't say it like that. But I'm putting it like that. Is that what you actually put? Did you give me the Millennials theme song? Yes. And it was actually like halfway through the song because I do kind of listen to that once in a while. let's see here. Yeah, 4 minutes. 4 minutes is good enough. Move that there. Let's see. Io Shirai, Candace. Selling on both. LeRae recovering from the match as Io holds up the belt and wipes her feet next to LeRae. There we go. So yeah, the idea that she's basically just wiping her boots right next to LeRae's face to just kick that up on her. Let's see here. So yeah, minor success. I guess it's a minor success. Just a bit of a nice little fuck you. Did I get that right? No, one more. There you go. All right. Jesus, look at all these segments. All right. Alex Reynolds, Tama Tonga. Holy crap. Let's see here. Let's see here. Alex Reynolds. It is kind of funny that just about anyone that I've seen, anyone that I've seen that streams or does like YouTube stuff and is over the age of like 26 or so gets immediately called old. It is kind of funny because just about any person I like, just about any YouTuber I've seen that's even around my age, like they get it, they get jokes about how old they are. it's weird. I guess not weird, but it's just one of those. I feel like it's just a running gag with anyone. Let's see. How do I want to do this? Should Tama call him out? Should there be a promo? Yeah, I think maybe there'd be a promo. Alright. Yeah, Reynolds backstage is looking forward to beating Tama again and wants Ray after. And I'd say about 3 minutes, 4 minutes. I think three minute promo segments tend to kind of die a little bit. I think four is usually like the bottom. So Reynolds versus Tama, we have that. Let's do Alex Reynolds, Tama Tonga, Brother Ray. Alex walks away as Ray tends to Tama and has EMTs care for him and carry him out. This isn't even, to be fair, this actually isn't even like a hardcore match. It's just there's going to be a stunt bump somewhere on like the ramp or something. And like that's going to end it. It's not even like a falls count anywhere or anything. Just a one-on-one. I'd say 4 minutes. We'll let this milk a little bit. We'll use his overness, which is pretty good. And his selling, I guess, is a good one. Maybe his entertainment or his acting. That's a good one. Success and the other two are just neutral. There you go. And put that there. And then we have Pete Dunne and Kushida. Ooh. Okay, Pete Dunne, Prince Devitt, Bob Sapp, Chris Hero, Adam Cole. Pete Dunne out with his belt. Pete Dunne out with hair. Just R&R fight team as they hype him pre-match for his title match. There you go. 5 minutes of that. So hey, we'll base it on his entertainment, and he'll talk too. They'll talk. He'll be a menace. Actually, they won't say anything. How about that? It'll just be Devitt, and then Bob Sapp will be menacing, and Pete Dunne. I feel like Pete Dunne won't even say anything. Maybe he'll just use his overness, which isn't going to be great, but I think it'll be fine. It'll be just good enough. I think Devitt's promo ability is also not great. So Bob Sapp's menace ability is what's going to carry this. Bob Sapp has to stand there and look intimidating. That's the whole point. So minor success of all them being out here like an actual MMA fight team. And we got Pete Dunne. We're going to have Kushida. And we're going to have Bob Sapp come running out there. We're also have Brock Lesnar come out running out there. So Kushida upset. Let's see. Locks Dunne in submission. Sapp with the save, but Brock out to let's see. Suplex him. How about that? Actually, I've got a better idea. All right, Prince Devitt. So we're gonna have Prince Devitt, Bob Sapp. Chris Hero and Adam Cole. So hang on. Locks Dunne in submission. R&R. We'll just do Chris Hero and Adam. Whoops. Oh my god, where is it at? There it is. And Adam Cole here. We're gonna have Kenny Omega, Nick Jackson, and Matt Jackson. R&R out for save. Elite out with weapons to chase off. There you go. I think like 5 minutes there. We'll milk it. We'll milk it a little bit. Get the audience a murmuring about the DQ. Kushida gets pissed. We'll even make it 6 minutes. Kushida gets pissed. Locks in an armbar, and just puts him in there. Rest of his fight team comes out, and building off of adrenaline, the Elite come out for the save. They bring weapons because they've been through hell and back. So, milk. Yes, we're going to. Oh my god, we're going to milk Pete Dunne and Kushida. I'm sure there's a fan fiction about that. okay, so yeah, the definitely selling, and it's a bit of a minor defeat and a low injury risk. He's gonna sell to success, and I'm gonna go with low on here because they're also gonna come in. Everyone's gonna come in swinging. So these guys are neutral. These guys get some minor success. Everyone's going to take a slight injury risk because they're going to be kind of fighting. And that's how you end the show. And look at that. I think for the first time ever, we're actually getting it in within the 3 hour, 45 minute mark. Now I have to look and see if there's anything else I might want.
Ooh.
That's right. We should do Drax. We need to do Drax the Destroyer and Rick McGarry. And they're going to sell. No, he's going to be Menace. He's going to sell. Actually, love him acting. Because I think his acting is better than his selling. And we're basically filming a fight scene, so... We'll give them low injury risk here. Why not? Drax and McGarry have the bar fight. Lots of various weapons. Ends with Drax power bombing. How much space do I have? Ends with McGarry power bombed through. Oh, damn it. Let's see. Drax and McGarry have bar fight, lots of weapons. Ends with McGarry powerbomb through pool table. A pool table is very sturdy, but he's about to get powerbombed through it. 6 minutes. I should just make it like 15, so it's just like it breaks a record for the new longest fight scene in history. It just takes up the rest of the time. I actually kind of think it'd be kind of funny, actually. Part of me wants to do that just because I have a spare 20 minutes. Just make this a 21 minute segment. Okay, how long is the They Live fight scene? Alright, let me see. They Live. Oh my god. Longest fight scene in a movie. It should be the longest 1-on-1 fight scene should be from They Live, as far as I know. The Raid 2. I'm pretty sure They Live is the longest one. If I remember right. Maybe we give them like 8 minutes to have this. We make it the new longest fight scene in cinema. I don't even think it would technically be considered it, but... I'm trying to see if it's technically... Nada versus Frank. I think it said something like 5 minutes. That's all right. Yeah, we'll go 6. How about that? Doesn't have to be too long. I guess it's a minor success because he's still beating up Drax. It's just Drax gets the better of him. So we'll put it before Reynolds Tama. So 1, 2, 3 maybe? Yeah, that's about where I'll do it. Sugar. Oh, what do aliens drink? I don't know. Piss. They just. Actually, we will use this. Actually, I have an idea. We will spend some time doing this because we'll build up some of the other stuff going on, like Father Kingston with Sammy and Eddie Edwards and Davey Richards. And random Shawn Michaels. Oh yeah, we gotta have John Hennigan and Shawn Michaels. Let's see. Kingston's sermon in church says he believes the time for Sammy's war is very soon. 5 minutes entertainment. The rest of them just sit there. Shawn Michaels will be entertaining. There you go. But it'll give him a little bit of something to do. And, oh God, where should we put that? I think all the way up here. Right there. Alright, what else is there to work with? You know, we should probably use some of our main eventers. Angle, Shane Hollister, Takahashi. I think so. Yeah, let's do day one. I'm gonna make sure these guys get their time in. Oh my God, will you quit your bitching? Matt Cage, Alpha Jr. I thought you only cared when he was actually in the fucking main event. Here we go. Day one in their locker room. Shane and Juice lament not winning. They know they can close in on... on success there. Good enough. Hollister isn't a smart favorite. That's the point. It's fun because he's someone people like. No one gives a shit about Alex Reynolds. He's not a smart favorite. I mean, you can still kind of watch him, but. And we'll put it up here somewhere. Probably the... right about there. Put some time in between matches. Reynolds has nice hair. Well, even now? Because he's got, like, that long, stringy hair. The shorter hair Alex Reynolds look, I liked. But, like, he's got, like, kind of that longer hair now. I don't know. Imagine the double stops if fans refuse to stop throwing chairs in. I could see that. Okay, so we did the day one thing. Hiromu. I feel like Hiromu needs to be involved somehow in... I feel like they wouldn't just have... Let me look at this. Okay, so yeah, that was a decisive match. Hiromu Takahashi... We can have Tetsuya Naito, and they could be in the back or somewhere else. I'm trying to think. Hollister doesn't even wrestle anymore, which is the way you love seeing him get a push. Yeah. What should I do with Hiromu and Naito? Oh, you know what? Vignette shows Hiromu back in Japan with Naito enjoying an amusement park with fun music over it. I think a good 5 minute montage of Hiromu and Naito at a Japanese amusement park, especially if it comes directly after the Omega Jericho match, to showcase the fact that they aren't there. Something just makes me giggle about the... Okay, so something makes me giggle. I can't remember the name of the song, but something just makes me giggle about the fact of Jericho and Omega going through hell. Jericho getting the shit kicked out of him by Omega. Omega barely able to stand. And then it fades from Omega limping away as Jericho is just a carcass in the ring to just Hiromu and Naito at an amusement park on a roller coaster while the fucking song, like, wouldn't it be nice if we... we're younger. Or I think it's older, yeah. Wouldn't it be nice if we were older? Yeah. Let me see. Wouldn't it be nice? I feel like I wouldn't. I don't want to play it because I know it's. I know it's. Yeah. Nothing will make me laugh more than just that. As Hiromu and Naito are just on a roller coaster, enjoying life. It would be fantastic. Because it's from Iowa biased. Hey. Part of it, but hey. Also, it's kind of fun having someone. Also, a lot of it also comes from trying to do something different than other people when they do TEW. Because no one, like, how many people do you see that push people that are just like, I mean, yes, I do push decently big names because I got Pete Dunne and Kushida in the main event. But not a lot of other people push like Shane Hollister or Alex Reynolds or Afa Noai Jr. or Cody Hall. You know, guys that maybe hardly anyone actually know. It's usually a rare thing to see. People might start pushing Juice in some of their promotions. But yeah, it's not a usual thing, I feel. Okay. Oh, right. We need to make sure that the vignette, the Hiromu vignette, appears right after that. We should do Tozawa and Doi doing something. In fact, I should probably shorten this up just a bit here. Let's see. I'll make it a minor. So, like, Tozawa Nuruki Doi. We show and Yo. They're going to talk. They're going to get a little bit there. Monster Max in their locker room are done with going nowhere and want to let's see, use their time going to and wants to, how about, wants to not get left behind. Because they could very easily get left behind in all of this. So they just quickly like, hey, we're done with this. We're doing something about this. So you know that they're doing something. All right, now I'm done. How many goddamn segments? I did 26 segments. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pre-show segments. We have a full goddamn show. Full show. All right. It's been an hour and a half and we're done. I won't use the post-show because I don't feel like it. All right, here we go. All right, so we are here. We sold it out. Okay, we did get that extra 100 tickets to sell out the Tacoma Dome in Tacoma, Washington. We start with the pre-show that I would assume is probably like on YouTube or something. And we start off with the opener. It is an Ignition, a Pro Wrestling Ignition showcase match featuring two members from Pro Wrestling Ignition. This time, Tacoma, Washington's own Shane Strickland versus Patrick Clark. Solid enough little match, doesn't really mean too much. Handspring back elbow gives Shane Strickland the win over Patrick Clark in just under 10 minutes. It's kind of an oof, but I mean, the pre-show is literally there to, I mean, stuff doesn't matter in the pre-show anymore. 2013 it did, 2016 it doesn't really matter, so that's why I do that. We get a vignette showing the rivalry of Sterling James Keenan and Ted DiBiase Jr.'s rivalry. It involves both of their debuts in Hawkeye Pro. And oh, what? Can't play music on two devices at once. Is my phone playing something? Why are we playing on two different devices? That was weird. I just got a thing that was like, hey, you can't play Google Play on, you can't play on two different devices at once. I'm like, I shouldn't be. It's only my computer and my phone. That's not good. By the way, it's really weird how Bo Dallas always gets these bangers of themes, and then they change it to something stupid. I'm kind of surprised no one got the Social Outcast theme yet. Two guys you push over Hollister with that shit tier matches. I'm sure they do better. But either way, Sterling James Keenan and Ted DiBiase's debuts, leading to a bit of a rivalry. Keenan feels that Ted Jr. Kind of stole his thunder with his debut, and led to the attacks on Ted DiBiase Jr., and now we get the match. Damn. All right, so Sterling James Keenan, solid wrestler. Ted DiBiase Jr., rusty as fuck. Is that? Oh, he's partially through a weight change. That might have something to do with it, because I wanted him to lose some weight, I think. And he's rusty. And he's inconsistent. I didn't say anti-Velveteen Dream. By the way, he's just Patrick Clark here. He wasn't Velveteen Dream when I got him. So Sterling James Keenan ends up locking him in with the 13th step and getting the win as Ted Jr. taps out. And Sterling James Keenan refused to let anti-Patrick Clark. Sterling James Keenan refuses to let go of the 13th step. Ted just keeps tapping. The bell is ringing. Refs and security come out to pull him apart. Sterling James Keenan has this look on his face. I have no idea if I can actually find the look, but he actually did this type of thing once already in NXT. In early NXT, he locked it in. He locked it in on him, and he had just this look on his face. It's very blurry, but yeah, this is how he looked. When Jake Carter's like tapping out and Corey Graves has this crazed look on his face as he's doing it. Like, he literally just looks insane. I want that to be the thing. But yeah, he looked a bit crazed as he continued the lock on, and it was just kind of funny. But yeah, either way, pulled apart. And basically, he looks a bit angry, but he looks like he's okay, and heads to the back as Ted Jr. is kind of clutching his leg. I'm just looking at more stuff and seeing that, like, Corey Graves just always looked crazy when he was locking that in. I'll just not worry too much about that. He just always looked a little crazy when he did it. There you go. So we get the Reinas coming out. Hikaru Shida, Ayaka Hamada, Nakajima, and Kobayashi all coming out to talk about the upcoming Women's Tag Team Championship match. Of course, the Tag Team Championship number one contenders match that was set for the pre-show has been moved to Breakout on Thursday. In its place is another Opportunity Trophy qualifying match, and Hikaru Shida is a part of it, and that is what we have next. Hikaru Shida versus Mercedes Martinez. Decent enough little match. Hikaru Shida getting the win after the Tomashi no 3 count in 15 minutes. And Hikaru Shida will now be joining Dash Chisako as the second official member of the Women's Opportunity Trophy match at Blackout. And Shida will have the opportunity to become the first and only two-time Women's Opportunity Trophy winner. Of course, she'd be the only one who actually won it too. So looking for perhaps a repeat, although she will have Very fired up Dash Chisako to contend with TEW, who is also competing later on tonight. Joey Styles and Shawn Michaels quickly run down the card for the next 3 minutes of Death Flag, urge you to purchase the show, and tells you that that is it. It's time. Buy the show. Call your local cable provider or probably the Fight TV. Well, actually, we're on rfvideonow.com. I don't even know if that's still a thing. Am I a manlet? I mean, I'm 6'4", so I would say no, because I think I think manlets are at least like 5'10". And considering I'm 6'4", I would say no. Either way, we start off Death Flag officially kicking off with Shinsuke Nakamura versus Taylor Mulligan. Nakamura coming down to the ring with his entrance. I'm a blonde. I'm not a ginger. The fuck? I feel like this is what happens when I don't really take pictures of myself. I don't take a lot of pictures of myself, so. So then we get these type of things. I was about to say something that I know it's gonna be taken the wrong way, but yeah, it's like I am just like blonde haired, blue eyed, yeah, and full of piss and vinegar. So Nakamura coming out for his entrance, interrupted by Taylor Mulligan, who attacks him from behind, throws him into the barricades, kind of beats him down a little bit, and tosses him in the ring as it's time for the match. And so we get Nakamura versus Taylor Mulligan. Nakamura absolutely carried Taylor Mulligan to this through this match. And it took about almost 14 minutes, but Taylor Mulligan ends up out of nowhere hitting the Galleria, locking Nakamura's neck, picking him up and dropping him with the Galleria, and gets a clean 1-2-3 in the middle of the ring to get the win over Shinsuke Nakamura. Taylor Mulligan celebrates at least a little bit. He tries to look like he knew this was coming, but he definitely has kind of a shocked expression somewhat on his face as he is kind of coping with the fact that, yes, he did beat Shinsuke Nakamura. His hand is raised, and he definitely seems excited. Live like an Mortimer, how much time do you spend on fucking 4chan? And I'm not fucking swole. I should be, but I'm too lazy. All you gotta know is the fact that I ordered Pizza Hut earlier tonight to know I ain't fucking swole. But it is time for the tag team match. Paul Heyman coming out to introduce Mayu and Miyu. Warns Dash and Kairi that they both have matches coming up at Blackout. And they made a bit of a mistake as compared, you know, made a bit of a mistake challenging Mayu and Miyu, because, you know, they could very easily soften them up. And who knows, they might not actually make it to Blackout because of what Heyman International is capable of doing. So if they really want to put that opportunity that they have next month on the line, then I guess that they can either choose to forfeit or put their lives on the line here. And so they opt to do that. God damn. All right. Miyu was just, she was the weak link, but it was fine. But yeah, either way, Jesus. Either way, an exceptional match in 91, which I did not expect. I knew Kairi and Dash, and I forgot Mayu was gonna do that. I forgot like one lone person's not gonna make it. What is the deep sea driver? It is because Kairi Hojo is now muscular. I decided to make her sort of like a swole Joshi. So the deep sea driver is the Steiner screwdriver. That is what I'm doing with that. So yeah, the deep sea driver, Kairi Hojo hits the deep sea driver on Miyu, and gets the win for herself and Dash. Yeah, if people have never seen the Steiner screwdriver, this is what it is. Whoops. Oh my god. I'm just trying to open it. Yeah, if you've never seen the Steiner screwdriver, this is it right here. Bam. Dead. And that's Kairi Hojo's new move. I'm trying to bury Psyche's gimmick. She's still there. In fact, we had a confrontation between the two where Reika had actually I think belly to belly suplexed Kairi. So we planted the seeds of like two swole Joshis. So Reika and Kairi had that standoff between them a few weeks ago, where Reika actually got a bit of an advantage over Kairi. We haven't completely addressed all of it, but it's there. Either way, Dash and Kairi get the win in a 91. So you're welcome, Miyu. It's probably the best you'll do for at least another year. So there you go. Deep Sea Driver getting the win, and Dash and Kairi escape. Who knows if Miyu did or not? Dash and Kairi celebrate, stand on the turnbuckles, and with the crowd as Mayu, Miyu, and Heyman walk to the back. And Kairi motions, does the championship belt motion, telling the crowd basically she is ready to win the title at Blackout. We move on, just a small angle in the back. Monster Max is in their locker room. And they seem to be silent for what feels like a good minute before Tozawa just angrily screams and basically quickly tells him, grabs Doi and tells Roppongi 3K that they are going nowhere right now, and they need to do something and figure out what they're going to do with themselves, because what they're doing now isn't working, and people are getting hurt. And they do need to stand on top of the stables, because a lot of stables are fighting each other right now to get up to the top of the hierarchy. And Monster Max does not want to get left behind. All right. I'm trying to pronounce your name. Larry's, maybe? But hey, how's it going? Is that a midget stable? No, it's a Japanese stable. I guess they all are technically juniors, to be fair. Because I think Doi might be the biggest of them, and he's still definitely a junior. Jericho and Omega come out. They got their street fight gear. Jericho comes out in his jeans that he usually wears for his street fights. I would love to see if Omega would be in a... Well, actually, no. Omega didn't come out in any sort of street fight gear, did he? Then again, Jericho didn't come out at Wrestle Kingdom 12 with anything like that, did he? I'm trying to remember. Chris Jericho Wrestle Kingdom 12 just came out in tights. Yeah. But if you're doing a street fight, Jericho would probably come out in jeans like he did the last time. I don't know if Omega would come out in jeans. Probably not. He'd probably just come out in probably just his regular pants. He'd probably come out in like his elite pants. Either way, they make their entrances. There's a bit of a tense moment before they eventually just start laying into each other with punches, and the bell rings and the match is on. And Kenny Omega trying to carry Chris Jericho to a decent match. He was visibly he was gasping for air at the end of this 17-minute match. And Kenny Omega got Chris Jericho's dad bod up for a one-winged angel and dropped him through. Knowing it's a street fight, it was probably either on a chair or through a table. I would like to see an avalanche one-winged angel I feel like Jericho might not be the person for that because it'd probably physically break him. But I feel like a one-winged angel like through a table from the top. Jericho is 50 in this timeline, yes. I think he's 50. I think he might have hit it. He might still be 49, but yeah. It's very, very close. I don't know. Let me see here. Chris Jericho. See, now that you've mentioned it. November 9th, 1970. So it's not yet November, so he's still 49. He's still technically 49. Yeah, Jericho getting carried in a match. Either way, he's getting carried through this. Through this street fight. He gets a one-winged angel for his troubles. As I would assume it's probably like through a table. And Omega gets the win. I can perform better if you use me in matches that suit my skills, put me in hardcore base matches, not play to my strengths. I understand, and I understand as well, but we needed something more than just, you know, regular matches. It's a crusade. A guy does not go through a crusade and not have some, you know, bloodbaths. I forget the terminology about can't do something without breaking a few eggs. Oh, can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs. Jericho just happens to be one of those eggs. And we're trying to make a delicious storyline omelet. And Jericho is unfortunately one of those eggs. Omega is barely able to stand. And he limps away towards the back as Jericho lies amongst the rubble, the chairs, and the tables and everything. As he has still remained motionless for a few minutes before they eventually help him to the back. Like that Triple H. But either way, yeah, Omega barely able to limp out. Jericho just barely, you know, just kind of stirring barely. And that immediately leads to a vignette. In case you were wondering, both Hiromu Takahashi and Tetsuya Naito are in Japan as a little five-minute vignette playing to the Beach Boys' Wouldn't It Be Nice, as Hiromu and Naito are back in Japan enjoying the sights and sounds, going to an amusement park, and just enjoying each other's company. And in case you want to know where they were, that's what they're doing. And we go back to the day one locker room, and none of them on the books, which has kind of been a rare thing for at least Shane Hollister. Juice has been kind of getting up there as well, but Shane and Juice kind of lament not being able to win the three-way dance. To earn themselves a title shot, and Shane laments, you know, losing the heavyweight championship. But they know that eventually they can close in on success. They just need to, pick themselves back up and find a way back into the main event. Shane can hopefully try to regain the title or help Juice try to win the title. But there you go. And maybe at some point they'll do something with Matt Cage, or they'll put Afa and Cody Hall into a tag title contention. We'll see. We need jobbers. Oh, no. That's Hiromu looking like he's trying to lick Naito is probably about the best description of 5 minutes of that. Samoa Joe and Robert Roode coming out. For their tag team title match. Joe is kind of moving his body around a little bit to show that he is feeling better than ever. Ended up having quick surgery and was able to make it back extremely quickly. And he's feeling better than he did when he first got injured. And he's ready to destroy a couple of young bucks and take the tag titles. Get some young lions. I do have some, sort of. They're named people, but I could do that. I mean, I'm what, about 10 months away from having dojo graduates? It'll still take a while. I think it takes a year. So I'm still a ways away from dojo graduates, but I think I'll eventually have some young boys to murder in times of need. And goddamn, wow, they cleaned up. They're cleaning the fucking floor. Jesus. Nonetheless, the Young Bucks and the cleanup crew roll up. Always. The Young Bucks end up going 19 and a half minutes with the cleanup crew. Matt Jackson, after perhaps a kick from Nick, ends up rolling up Samoa Joe. Not really clean as a whistle, but still pretty damn clean. Ends up pinning him with a roll up as he was, Joe was unable to kick out in time. Young Bucks making their second official defense of the tag team titles. And big match Nick Jackson standing above everyone with that 100. They just had to make sure you knew Nick Jackson was head and shoulders above everyone else, even his own goddamn brother. Jesus. And it suffered from a lack of psychology. Again, I don't know. Patrick was at the least here from near day one. I mean, he kind of raised a good point. And when he left, it wasn't really on his own terms. It was me getting rid of him. Or Colby Carino. Colby Carino's down in developmental. He's literally been here since day one. Who knows? We'll see what happens. Let's see here. So yeah, Bucks beating cleanup crew and 95 is ridiculous. Bucks haul it out of there. Joe is furious. Joe is up to the Carino and Hall were a tag team throughout one of the first, like within like the first couple of years. So yeah, Carino and Hall could, well, I mean, they don't have like I don't know if they have the chemistry, but yeah, Carino and Hall were they were teaming up quite a bit. I forget who they were with. I think there was someone else as well. But yeah, they were around. I think they were with like Caleb Conley or someone else. Might have been Alex Reynolds. I'd have to go look in my TEW 13 history. Yeah, the Young Bucks is not equal psychology. So Bucks haul it out of there. Joe is pissed. Rude is pissed. Joe is basically at the ropes, holding it open, begging for the Young Bucks to come in and get an ass kicking. Young Bucks are having none of it. They're grabbing their titles and they're walking backwards to get the hell up out of here. And there you go. So Joe is unhappy that he got rolled up and the Bucks survive. We go to a random church in Tacoma where Father Kingston is on the pulpit again. Sammy Sabay has the television title. Davey and Eddie are there with John Hennigan. Off in the corner, Shawn Michaels. Just enjoying the nice little Saturday night service. Of course, it was pre-taped. But, yeah. Either way, Kingston has a sermon where he starts speaking more gloom and doom than he did a few days ago. And he says he believes the time for the war that he talked about a few days ago might already be here. A random church in Tacoma. And he believes that the war is here for Sammy. It'll be here very soon, and that television title might be in danger. So to prepare himself. Paul Heyman comes out with Io Shirai for her women's championship match. Heyman intros Io Shirai, and as he's about to talk on the mic a little bit more, Io takes the mic away from him. She does not look happy with Candice LeRae. And she tells LeRae, she done fucked up on Thursday, just two nights ago. Io Shirai's neck is still a little bit sore, but she's feeling good, and she's feeling like she can kick Candice LeRae's ass. And honestly, she was just going to make this a nice little sporty event, this title defense against Candice LeRae. But since she managed to hit her with a reverse Rana and perhaps try to take her out and break her neck, Io Shirai is just going to murder her. So, yeah, it's Io Shirai has just decided, I'm just going to murder Candace. And she doesn't straight up murder her, but 18 and a half minutes later, she definitely gets the better end. Yeah, see, they don't seem to click, and it made for an awkward bout. And she got a 68. Even Io doesn't even hit an 83. She usually hits the 90s. So, yeah, Io and Candace did not really work out as well as I thought. But it still says fantastic heat and great wrestling. So I guess it was good. Io Shirai, the wrestler taking the mic from Promo God. I mean, it's Io fucking Shirai. And 1843 hits her with the moonsault press. That is her eighth official defense of the Hawkeye Pro Women's Championship. And Io Shirai doesn't quite kill Candace, but is definitely gotten the better of her here and made her victory. Your friendly stream. I try. By the way, hey Goofy. I was going to say it's been a while, but I think I said that last week when it was quite a while. I need to look at the Hall of Champions again, because that officially it brings the most record. Brings the record up to 8 again. So Io Shirai still going in with this Okada-like run with the title. 8 official defenses of the Hawkeye Pro Women's title. That's the current reigning record for most defenses of the women's title. 6 p.m. Finland time. Holy shit, it's 10 a.m. I should really deeply consider going to bed. I should really deeply consider going to sleep as soon as I'm done with this. Holy shit. I forgot I started this at like 4:30 in the morning. So yeah, and we're now just hitting 4 hours and 59 minutes. Either way, Candice LeRae is recovering from the moonsault press. She kind of like looks towards, it like rolls towards EO, who's holding up the championship belt and celebrating. And just wipes her feet next to Candace, and just try to kick up whatever crud on the mat there might be into Candice LeRae's face, and walks out with the belt. And there you go, Io Shirai still the champion. So we had the build up a couple days ago on Breakout. Drax the Destroyer and Rick McGarry had gotten on either side of each other after at a random bar as Drax was looking for Helmsy the Creator. And oh my god, what the building of Azumi. But either way, the buildup has happened. And the big Drax the Destroyer Rick McGarry bar fight happens. Lots of weapons thrown about. They throw each other around, break bottles and pull cue sticks and all sorts of stuff over each other. And McGarry holds his own against Drax. But then eventually Drax gets a hold of McGarry, power bombs him through a pool table, which is not an easy thing to do. But uses his power to throw powerbomb McGarry through a pool table and leaves him lying virtually unconscious as Drax leaves the bar, perhaps once again in search of Helmsley the Creator. Alex Reynolds is backstage talking about this match with Tama Tonga. He's looking forward to beating Tama again. He talks about the various times that he has beaten Tama Tonga. And looks forward to doing it again. And basically calls a shot that says once he is done with Tama Tonga tonight, he's coming after Brother Ray. And he wants to end things with Brother Ray. He wants that conclusion, and it'll probably end with Brother Ray getting very, very hurt. There you go. That's about what I was expecting. How was there a lack of psychology between these two? Fuck yourself. Exceptional match, though. Nearly 24 minutes. Alex Reynolds getting the win over Tama Tonga. Hits him with a claymore kick. Brother Ray at one point comes in. I feel like I probably should have put that into the match. Like, it should have been definitive. Probably shouldn't have ended with the finisher. But nonetheless, they had fought their way perhaps up the ramp towards the stage. And it looked like Tom was about to throw Alex Reynolds off the stage. And Brother Ray was going to help him. Let's say there was a bunch of tables down on the bottom. But nonetheless, Alex Reynolds gets out of the way. And Brother Ray ends up, nailing Tama off the stage through the tables. Then Brother Ray takes a bit of a bump himself off the stage. And as Tama starts stirring, Alex Reynolds comes up and Claymore kicks him in the face and gets the 3 count on him. Because why not? Just a random false count anywhere in a match that really wasn't false count anywhere. But nonetheless, we get Tama Tonga his stunt bump, and it leads to the finish. Alex Reynolds, Claymore kicking him in the face and getting the victory. And Alex walks away. Brother Ray is shocked, tends to Tama Tonga, who seems to have EMTs who need to care for him, as it definitely seems like he got seriously hurt, not just on the fall, but on the Claymore kick as well. And EMTs eventually carry Tama Tonga out while Brother Ray looks on, also a bit hurt from the hit he took from Alex Reynolds as well. Pete Dunne coming out with the rest of the Rock and Roll Fight Team, like as if it's a big MMA UFC fight. Comes out with the belt, and Devitt hypes him up pre-match. First title match, bringing in the various things that Pete Dunne has done throughout his career, and having the, he hasn't done much, but Prince Devitt hypes him up as a submission machine and a wrestling machine, and of course as the heavyweight champion. And that leads to our main event for the heavyweight championship, Pete Dunne versus Kushida. And an exceptional match. Gets to the end. Pete Dunne looks like he might actually lose against Kushida. Pete Dunne then slaps the referee and intentionally gets himself disqualified. So not really an official defense. However, even though Kushida wins, it is by disqualification. Ref called for the bell after getting slapped around by Pete Dunne. And Kushida wins by disqualification. However, Pete Dunne still the heavyweight champion. And that is the main event. Still got a 94, even with kind of a screwy finish. It didn't seem like it meant that much. It's great that the match that I based it off of has the same referee, because I was able to get Mike Chioda. So Pete Dunne slapping Mike Chioda, gets disqualified, gets to keep the title. Kushida ain't happy about that shit. And ends up locking Dunne in a submission, forcing him to tap out, even though the match is clearly over. Pete Dunne repeatedly tapping. The rest of the Rock and Roll Fight Team coming down, or at least Devitt, Hero, and Cole does. And as it looks like they start pulling Pete Dunne off, and it looks like they're going to start laying in on Pete Dunne, Kenny Omega limps out with Nick and Matt Jackson as they're carrying weapons with them. I'd say probably kendo sticks. And Mike Yoda's a moron. Come out with kendo sticks, I would say, or chairs, maybe a mixture of both. Kenny Omega's probably using the stick to keep himself propped up, because it was only like an hour ago that he went through hell and back. It was an hour and a half ago, because he had the women's title and the other title. Yeah, it was probably good. It was probably an hour ago, plus this, so probably an hour and a half. But either way, Elite come out and beat them off with the chairs and kendo sticks. Beat them away with the chairs and kendo sticks. I know what's going to happen when the delay catches up. I know what's going to happen. So the Elite come to the aid of Kushida, and they just kind of leave it at that as they check on Kushida as the Rock and Roll Fight Team kind of leave with their tails between their legs. Pete Dunne still has the belt, though. So what's going to happen? Nothing. I'll just say nothing. No, nothing happened. It was just something that I said that I feel like was going to get picked up on and would make jokes about it, because that's just what tends to happen. God, even this was over 2 hours. Fuck. Usually I can get these done in an hour and a half. Either way, Elite come for the save. Pete Dunne still the champion. There you go. Okay, we're going to give Io Shirai credit. Told that she's awesome for carrying Candice LeRae. Let's see here. Oh, yeah, this is, what is it? Legend of the Spaceborne Killer by Crobot, as far as the background music is concerned. Who else should get? Nakamura. Okay. Shinsuke Nakamura is praised for a great performance, because he's, you know what? Yeah, he's told that he's awesome, because, hey, he's awesome for putting over Taylor Mulligan. And who else? Oh, Kenny Omega. Kenny Omega is going to be told that he's awesome for carrying Chris Jericho to a half-decent match. All right, seemed pleased. He was pleased, seemed pleased. All right, cool. Now I got some extra money to throw out because I pissed off some people with the booking. So I got some money to pay off my wrestlers. good job for booking something right. Hey, wow. The fuck is with you? I'm a goddamn tremendous booker. Death flag, number one thing. Let's go. Even World Pro Wrestling from New Japan. Look at that. What's Stardom at? Stardom's at a 58 with Kyoko Kimura having to come out of retirement and face Hiroyo Matsumoto. Where's New Japan? Why don't I see New Japan? World Pro Wrestling. Look at that. Even we even beat New Japan. And that had King Ace and the Millennials. Oh my god, King Ace and the Millennials. Why is Makabe still being featured? That featured Okada versus Yano in the main event. That'd be insane, honestly. Get Brock Lesnar 1.5 million for a 3-minute match. Vince Russo said that. Look what happened to him. Wow. Let me see if anything happened here. Doesn't look like anything. Okay. Death flag buy rate 0.41. What is that? How does that work with, did we go up from the last one? Let me see here. Death flag 2020. 165,000 to 208,000. There you go. There you go. We are not going to make 2 million though. So much of that's about to go to taxes. Let me spend some of it first. First, let's talk to Sean Spears. WWE isn't offering him anything, so we can lowball his offer and bring him in. I don't know why they didn't want to. I mean, it feels like he wouldn't be that bad, but sure, why not? I don't know what I'm going to name him, though. Should I just name him, like, the Perfect 10? Like, not even Ty Dillinger, just, like, the Perfect 10? I could just go for Sean Spears. I don't even have to do that. I wonder who took Stardom's top talent for it to end up like this. Hey, David, what's up? Stan Spears. All right, Kushida's pissy. I think he was pissy last time. So we'll continue. We'll give him some money to hopefully make him less pissy. I'd say $15,000 will make him less pissy. He's still annoyed with me. Really? Because you lost it. Look at that. He's that pissed off. Because it's literally the only thing. He's so pissed off about the fact that he had to not win the title and have Pete Dunne. Look, giving the title to Pete Dunne has permanently made Kushida pissed off at me. Just Stan. That is a good Stan the Stud Spears. Oh my god. Giving Pete Dunne the title has pissed off Kushida so much. And he's so much more over. Holy shit. Kushida is fucking over, boys. All right, Johnny Gargano's, I don't know why he's pissy. He's, I don't know. Probably just booking. Nakamura's annoyed here. Nakamura can be less at 52,000. Oh, God. So he's going to take a lot more. Let's give him 27. All right, he's still annoyed, but he's happy. He's still furious about having to put over Taylor Mulligan. He's still furious for having to put over Taylor Mulligan. That's all right. I got enough money. So I use some of it to make people slightly less pissed off, and it'll be fine. Dojo's not costing me too much. 4,800. That's nice. That Future Endeavors contract? No. And shit on you for pushing Elijah Burke? Hey, he's the Black Pope. Why would I shit on you for that? All right. Oops. There we go. I should have Dillinger's gimmick be he's just Stan, and he's come back to get his revenge on Shawn Michaels. And then Shawn Michaels comes out of retirement to face Stan. That's how he comes out. He doesn't come out as Ty Dillinger. He just comes out as Stan and just starts beating the shit out of Shawn Michaels in his debut. He's come for his revenge. Injury sidelines AR Fox. Displaced Ulrich Cranon fracture. Jesus. All right. End of the month. Athena has relocated to the Mid-South. So back to Texas. Gotcha. Women's Opportunity Trophy. Look at that. They took how much? They took almost $1 million. Because we had about $12 million, and now we're at 10.6. They took $865,000 in taxes. We made too much money. Because we made like an extra $60,000 in pay-per-view revenue. Our TV revenue is, well, it's not as good. But then again, January actually had an extra show. So, cease all of this. Ramen Pro will happen. His hype his debut by having Sean receive creepy fan letters as if they're written by a Stan. Oh, I should look at the titles real quick, at least for us. I don't give a shit about the other ones. Look at that. Look at that dropped prestige. Did you know that Shane Hollister brought the prestige up to a 100? Yeah, Shane Hollister brought the prestige up to a 100. What's that? Tag team titles are still at 100. Television titles at 100. The women's titles at a 95. Oh, it dropped a little bit. See, putting Candice LeRae in the title match. Look at that. 83 is actually the worst title match since back in September with Hikaru Shida. Women's tag team at an 85. I'm sure it'll go up at the next one. Opportunity Trophy. Women's. I can't wait for the Women's Opportunity Trophy to join the other things. Also, I'm not 100% sure if the Royal Riot's going to be a thing after this year. I feel like I'm going to do something else other than a Royal Rumble type thing. I'll see what happens. I still got, I got like 9 months to think about it. Watching TEW is giving you motivation to do TNA. Yeah. You can always try it. I think that is it, though, because, Jesus, this is almost 2.5 hours. This is over 5 hours of streaming. Oh, God. There you go. I'm done. My mouth has gone dry. I'm pretty much out of stuff to drink. I'm tired. It's 10 in the morning. I should be in bed asleep right now. But, hey, I'm here. I've done that. We are into March. Everything's looking pretty good. I think, let me look at the importance. 65. Let's see. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6. So 7 and 8 right here. Haven't quite hit 65. and we would technically be national, but I ain't doing that because I'm making too much money and I want to have a network. That is my idea now, is to have a network. So, oh my God. I want to see what happened with Taylor Mulligan beating Nakamura. 47. I mean that did okay. I feel like he really needs to get pushed. I figured a match like that would push him up a little bit higher. But he hasn't gotten insane. I hope Nakamura didn't get a huge loss from that. I mean, it was only a couple points. We can get that back. That's easy enough to get back. He lost a couple points, but that's about it. I mean, I'm still paying him way more than he's worth. I'm still paying him like $20,000 more. Either way, I'm done. So thank you guys. I appreciate you guys coming out here. If you're watching this on YouTube, thank you very much for going through all this. Or at the very least, watching the ending when I was going through all that, because that was a long-ass thing, too, and I got sidetracked in all sorts of other crap. So you guys being here and being a part of it was great. I appreciate it. Yeah, you guys in the chat, I appreciate you guys coming here, too. I guess because of my 2 weeks, I'll be doing this again next week. But, yeah, we got March coming up. And, yeah, that'll give us another month. We'll have Blackout. And then after that, we're back to the Grand Prix, boys. Grand Prix 2020 is 1 month away. So, at end of the month, we got that second Women's Opportunity Trophy match. We got the big Blackout pay-per-view, one of our big four. And 1 month from, and just over a month, is the start of the Hawkeye Pro Grand Prix. Can't wait, because I'm excited. I already have, I haven't figured out all the specifics, but the general booking is pretty much done. So, fingers crossed on people not getting hurt. I'm excited because a good chunk of the booking is pretty much done. The general outline of how it's going to work is done. So, I'm excited to see how that comes out. So, yeah. Thanks, guys. I appreciate it, and I will see you guys next time.